here now, pleased to welcome our next-gen POS power panel, including the CEO and co-founder, Clover from First Data, John Beatty, the president, North America of Ingenico Group, Oscar Bello, the CEO and co-founder, Revel Systems, Lisa Falzone, the executive vice president of systems at Verifone, Glen Robson, and our moderator, the chief content officer at Money 2020, Andrew Morris. Well, let me tell you something, all that glitters ain't gold. It's been a long old trouble, long old troublesome road. Been looking for somebody, come and help me carry this load.
Well, all right, I have to say, I really like that song. I really do. So that's on the playlist from now on. So I'm Andrew Morris. I'm the Chief Content Officer at Money 2020. And welcome to the last hour of what's been an amazing 3 days, three nights here at Money 2020. I'd like to thank all of you for staying engaged right to the final note. But then again, why wouldn't you? Because we have a great panel, a group of panelists today. So representing four companies that are really defining what is next-gen POS. And we'll be talking about that for the next 30 minutes or so. Clover, now a part of First Data, Ingenico Group, Revel Systems, and Verifone. But before we dive in, I wanted to take this opportunity to say a thank you. As Chief Content Officer, I'm responsible for developing the agenda for the event, working with our great Money 2020 team. It's something we do. We spend the whole year to do. We'll go home, catch our breath, start to evaluate what happened this year, and look at how to make it better for next year. And we'll work on it all year. And it's absolutely a thrill to see that come to life. We've had very strong engagement. If you've been in the sessions in this room and upstairs, great attendance, and I appreciate that. And we have 545 speakers at this event, and I wanted to say thank you to them. They make this event what it is. And the panelists, presenters, moderators that spend their time, share their insights, make their announcements at the event. So from the Money 2020 stage, I just wanted to say thank you to them. If you could join me with a round of applause, some of our speakers may be in the audience. Yeah. So let's dive in. So the business at hand, what is next-gen POS anyway? So point of sale is no longer a fixed piece of hardware at the front of the store with a narrow set of capabilities. In fact, you could argue that this has become as much a software-driven industry as it is a hardware-driven industry. With internet-connected mobile devices in the hands of consumers and store associates, cloud computing, new access technologies like NFC, Bluetooth, on and on, the whole notion of POS is changing. And so we're going to take the first segment of our time here, show you a few videos from each of the companies that give some examples of how this is happening, and then have a conversation about it. So if we could roll the first video. See you later, alligator. Awesome. So see you later, alligator, not your grandpa's POS. So Verifone Carbon, which was actually announced earlier this year at Money 2020 Europe. So Glen, talk a bit about, you know, why is that announcement so important? And what role does it play in your kind of personal and the company's vision for next-gen POS?
Thanks, Andrew. Yeah, I think, you know, if anything embodies our vision of where the POS is going, it's probably most realized in carbon. And I think for a couple of reasons. One, it's a highly integrated solution. So we start delivering a payment system which is directly connected to the rest of the POS. But even more importantly, of course, it's a platform that now runs a set of applications. And I think that when we think about the future of POS, it's taking on a far broader role than it has in the past. You said it yourself earlier, software is now the key. We have to be in the epicenter of an ecosystem of software applications, which includes CRM, which includes inventory management, and includes accounting packages, so that we become the beating heart, particularly for the small and medium businesses, where it's difficult for them to have the scale of those kind of things to buy an integrated solution for themselves. We need to be the point of integration. Something like Carbon allows us to get an application platform, an open application platform. We have our own commerce platform, which belies that, which actually allows any application, certified application, to talk directly to our payment app in a very secure way. We manage the secure payment data through the Engage engine, but any application can now have a direct connection to the front of screen in front of the customer. And of course, that means we can now have a dialogue with that customer directly. So we can offer to pay with points, we can redeem points. The whole CRM discussion between the point of sale and the person making the payment can become an enlivened experience rather than just swiping or tapping.
Sure, sure. So that's interesting. So a lot of it is, you know, POS. Well, what's even the scope of that? We were talking about backstage. What does it even mean? You talked about things like CRM and inventory, and it's not just the payment transaction. How do you see in your world at Verifone and what you're focused on? What's the scope of what? And when you look to the future, what's the scope?
Yeah, I think obviously that we consider in scope the merchant customer experience, right? We have to be driving an entirely different type of experience than we've been capable of in the past. So we've got more powerful engines. We've got open systems, which allow application developers to bring whole new types of applications to bear. I think mobility in store is critically important. As you saw, Carbon actually is capable of lifting off its stand. And it facilitates that one-to-one client experience that I think people are getting used to and getting to love. It's a far greater level of identification with the customer than we've been able to provide in the past. And of course, there are technical capabilities like Bluetooth LE and beacons, et cetera, whereby we expect to enhance that experience even further.
Sure. Okay, thank you. Okay, let's video number two. Roll the next video for us, please.
Thank you.
So great. So it's interesting, Oscar, we were having this discussion around scope, and that last graphic that pops up on the video sort of speaks to that. So this is Telium Tetra, maybe talk about that, and then our question of what is next-gen POS, where are we going?
Sure, so first of all, thanks for having me.
Yeah.
I think the video is a great example of what we see as the next generation POS, and it's not about payment acceptance anymore. It's about a point of engagement, a point of interaction. The point of sale device on that countertop or wherever it is has become a center for merchants to really manage their entire business. When you combine that with a marketplace that's very rich in applications, in business applications, it really gives merchants the ability to do much more on a POS device, to expand their business, to create new business opportunities, to offer more services, and ultimately to grow their businesses and to manage them in a much more efficient manner. So we really see that this point of interaction and this point of engagement becoming very powerful on the desktop, and really leading to the future of commerce. So the point of sale has come a long way. It's no longer just about payment. It's much more than just payment.
Excellent. And there's the notion of payment service providers and their role in that platform. Maybe to talk about that.
Sure. I mean, so we believe that the key to that to our marketplace and to providing those business applications is to have an open architecture that allows a broad range of developers to create applications. I mean, applications, it's as creative as you want to be. And we make that marketplace very open. We allow developers to work on that platform, and we keep to what we do best, which is security, global connectivity, and the payment portion of it. And we're not everything to everybody, but we certainly provide that platform to leverage our expertise in the industry and to be able to provide those business applications that merchants are looking for.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so next video. So great. So Lisa, so a little different focus here. The smaller merchant, Revel, I guess, plays a little different role in the ecosystem than some of the other panelists. So maybe talk about that and kind of your thoughts on this question of, you know, what's the future?
Yeah. So I think the definition of point of sale is an interesting one, and I think that it's thrown around, and I think it has a lot of we view really point of sale as really a mini SAP for your business. And we really focus on high volume, single store locations and chains and franchises. We think there's a difference between a point of sale, and we think there's a difference between a register, and we think there's a difference between point of sale and a payment terminal. So we actually view these guys right here as partners.
Right.
And we really view Revel as being really the next generation Aloha, Micros, NTR, really those systems that are able to go into, for example, we just announced Shell, our global partnership with Shell, Cinnabon, Focus Brands, and that's really how we view point of sale.
Okay, excellent. So so definitely the conversation about is it a software or a hardware, I guess maybe you would side with it's becoming a software business.
Definitely software. Yeah. I mean, what we've done is we've taken off-the-shelf hardware, and we're a software provider. And so we've been lucky because we've been able to take what Apple has spent billions of dollars creating put a card swiper, cPrinter, cash drawer, stand, and then all the other peripherals on that. And then we've been able to eliminate the back office server and host everything in the cloud. Mm. And so absolutely, it's cloud-based, it's software, and it's real-time. And that's really the future of point of sale. And that's where we see ourselves in the marketplace.
Okay, super, thank you. So one more, last but not least, one more video for us, please, thanks.
Running a small business means you're always running. Each day brings its long list of jobs to get done and many hats to wear. We get it. It's why we created Clover, an all-in-one management tool that takes care of business. From accepting payments, to selling more to current customers or reaching new ones, to the daily tasks that keep your business humming, Clover is in your corner. It's the only system out there with a custom app market specifically designed to meet the needs of small business. Whatever you need done, Clover's got an app to help. And it's backed by the world's leading payments processor, so you can be sure of fast, reliable, secure transactions. Whatever the job, wherever you do it, front office, back office, no office, Clover's got you covered.
So John, so we saw a lot of things in there, gift card, rewards, app-based, multiple channels, secure. So maybe talk about what we saw there and your
Yeah, talk. Sure. So when we started Clover, we had a real problem. Like back in 2011, we were a mobile wallet company, and we were trying to provide a very different kind of consumer experience in the store. We wanted an instant sort of personalization. We wanted the merchant to know who we were, what we ordered, have a card on file. And so we were working on that, and then we hit sort of a major roadblock, and that was point of sale integration. Like trying to bring that new consumer experience to point of sale was just very, very difficult. Point of sale radically fragmented, a lot of stovepipe systems built over the years. That stovepipe nature of those applications is what led to sort of radical fragmentation. Now there's like thousands of point of sale systems in the US alone. So we started thinking about how would you rebuild point of sale from the ground up as a platform, an open platform, open APIs, modular, so that anyone can come in sort of and extend the system to do new things, adapt it to new industries, adapt it to new verticals, and enable all sorts of new consumer experiences. And so, for us, next-gen point of sale, my kind of cheeky answer, but it's actually true, is I don't know, but I built a platform to find out. And so it's kind of the unexpected that's really exciting. And just in the course of the last couple days here, I've heard lots of interesting ideas that I've never had myself, which is great. I mean, that's what's sort of exciting about it to us.
Okay, super. So thank you for that. I think that was very helpful, sort of paint the picture all the way across the board. So let's move into the next topic. So, and it's who is disrupting who or what? That's our topic now. We on this very stage on Monday, we saw Jack Dorsey with Square, Osama Bedier from Point. We've had other great companies like NCR and SumUp and on our agenda. It seems that there's a lot of new players, that maybe the space is a little more crowded than it's been historically. So that's interesting. And then this is the notion of who's disrupting what, like the store experience, or are there any things that you see there? So let's just go around, and Lisa, I'll have you start with this. So I know you talked about how you're not viewing yourself as competing in a lot of the cases here. It's you're partnering with Ingenico and Verifone. But when you think about what's being disrupted by the new players, what do you think?
Well, I think there's a lot of disrupting going on. it's a big buzzword. But again, I mean, we're really we view ourselves as a mini SAP for people's businesses.
Yeah.
And we view ourselves as, again, the point of sale for high volume single store locations and chains and franchises. We do not compete with like Square Register. They go on a much, much lower end of the market.
Right.
And it's huge, huge market, so there's a lot of opportunity. But we are really focused on really providing inventory analytics, aggregate reporting, purchase orders, automating that for the high volume SMB all the way up to the Shells of the world, the biggest chain in the world.
Right. Right, but those providers in that space, like you mentioned, Aloha and so forth, that's where
we actually work with them to go after as far as we would connect with Ingenico or Verifone as our payment terminal.
Right,
and we're really focused on the software.
Right.
So we actually partner with them to go after some of these clients.
So John, what are your thoughts on this?
Yeah, I agree. Disruption's a bit of a big buzzword.
It is a buzzword indeed.
But it is interesting, yeah. Right? So I mean, in general, right? Software is disrupting hardware. Platforms are disrupting products. And so, as I view it, all these sort of trends are happening. And also, if you provide a platform out there, that enables even sort of more disruption. So, you know, we have a number of, you know, really interesting partners that have come onto our platform. We have this pilot that Google has, you know, invited us to participate in with Google Hands Free, right? So it provides that sort of mobile wallet experience that we were trying to build back in 2011.
Right.
Couldn't get sort of the technology out there. So that's very interesting. And it provides the ability for others to disrupt sort of other parts of the ecosystem. Then we have other partners that we're enabling to bring their solutions to market. Like, you know, I heard earlier comments, cloud computing has sort of lowered the barriers to entry for all startups. We're trying to lower the barriers to entry to the people who are trying to provide more value upstack, right? So that's just sort of the generally the way of the world. All the value is going to move upstack, and so we want to provide a platform to unleash all that innovation and disruption.
So Oscar, we think about this. So there's players like Revel, where it's a potential partner. That's a new player, and then there may be cases where you are competing for business with new players. How do you see the sort of competitive dynamic in the space, and then this buzzword of disruption? What are your thoughts on that?
So at Ingenico, we reserve the word disruption just for the card brands. So only they're the ones that disrupt the market. I think in general, what we see is that there's an evolution in payments, and that evolution is caused by a lot of innovation. So all of the companies that are sitting here in this panel are innovating in their way, and I think if you go through that through the exhibit hall, you'll see plenty of innovation. So I wouldn't call it disruption, I would call it innovation.
Right.
And I think everybody has their vision of where they're going. Clearly, you know, we can't be everything to everybody. And I don't think any one of us here at the table can be everything to everybody. But, you know, we have our unique ways. You know, we have our Ingenico Labs division, which focuses on innovating. We look at acquiring assets that could bring innovation. But we also depend on partners. So the partnership ecosystem is extremely important in this industry. And we expect to continue. We leverage it today, and we expect to continue to leverage it. And that's what's going to really lead to the innovation. So again, I wouldn't call it too much disruption. I would call it more innovation and evolution.
So the new players and technology is sort of pushing everyone forward.
Sure.
Right. So Glen, any other closing thoughts on that, or should we?
Yeah, I think for a company like Verifone that's been around since the inception of modern payment technologies, disrupting ourselves is the first thing we've got to get our heads around.
Right.
You know, history is littered with companies who waited for someone else to disrupt them. I love what's going on in the industry. I think it's driving a lot forward. I think it's right. It's about innovation, but I would say it's beyond evolution at this point. I think we're in a payments revolution, and we're all going to have to work in partnership, in fact, to go drive the kind of experiences that we want to.
Excellent. So we're going to have to go fast. So we're going to the speed round. So we'll keep our answers short, and I'll ask each of you a different topic and just kind of dive in. So we'll go back to Lisa. So how are the needs of your I said SMB, but actually it could be larger chain stores. But how are those needs different than a larger enterprise customer? You're working with Shell, and you're working with is it a common thread, or are they really unique and you have to solve for small or large?
Yeah, I mean, we're lucky because the way we build our product, we can go from the SMB up into the large enterprise. But yes, there's absolutely unique requirements for the enterprise versus SMB. With the enterprise, I mean, aggregate reporting is really huge. And inventory management is really huge. And what makes the cloud, a cloud-based point of sale so revolutionary and so helpful for these enterprises is that they can view everything from one website in real time. Where right. You look at, the Micros terminals, the Aloha terminals that all use back office servers, they've got to go, they got to download it, a report. Nothing's in aggregate, nothing's in real time. And so with our solution, they can make real time solutions. They don't have to deal with the maintenance of the back office server. And so, which really, to use a buzzword, disrupting.
Well, sure. Now you did it, not me. I know how. The retail point of sale is notoriously slow for being able to push changes out, and so that dynamic
exactly,
changing.
And we can provide that, and we can provide changes, and we can push changes, and
right.
We can give them those analytics in real time.
Right, so. So we'll move to Oscar. So, omnichannel, another buzzword, but if POS now includes more than in-store payment, and I think maybe it does, right? So how are ways do you create that integrated experience for online? Yeah,
so seamless omnichannel, even a bigger buzzword, right?
Even bigger buzzword.
So we look at omnichannel, and we believe omnichannel is being able to enable every point of interaction into a point of purchase. So we believe that's key in how we offer omnichannel. So. But the key to all of it is security. You can go onto a merchant's website and the look and feel of the payments can be the same, whether it's on a mobile device or whether it's online or whether it's in-store. But if it's not secure, then you don't have a seamless transaction. You begin to lose faith in those merchants. So that's part of making sure that you offer a good omni-channel offering. The second part of it is cross-border. So omnichannel really, besides consolidating data, it brings the opportunity for merchants to get bigger, to go global, to compete with larger players at a larger scale. So we've got to make sure that we give them those cross-border capabilities. And that's what we've done at Ingenico. We've put together a suite of products that really enable us to accept or enable our customers to accept payments from every channel. And to be able to consolidate them, and not only that, but to also accept payments in a universal way, globally speaking, no longer limited by just borders. So I think those are the keys to having a good omnichannel offering.
Excellent. So thank you. So John, we'll go to you. So one of the recent developments that's really interesting is developer app marketplaces at the point of sale. So when you think about that, what are some of the biggest challenges with that, and what are the greatest opportunities you see there?
Sure, it's always fun to start with the biggest opportunities, so I'll start there.
Okay.
So one of the things that's historically been very, very difficult for people trying to provide solutions to the small and medium business space is how do you reach them, how do you market to them, and how do you get your product delivered to them? And so this was a problem that I lived sort of back in 2011. So when we created this platform, the big goal was how do we get it to scale so it matters, right? And it's only once you're at scale that it can help and serve other developers. And so so now we launched in early 2014. We've launched shipped about 375,000 devices, and that's really provided a great sort of launching vehicle for a variety of our app market partners who have been able to launch their products with us. So. A good example of this is a company called Homebase. They do employee management, employee scheduling, time clocks. We make it as simple for the merchant as pushing a button to install the app, and now they turn their point of sale device into a time clock, and they can get all these great other features. So that's sort of the big opportunity, is allowing these developers to get to mass market. Big challenge. How do we get to enough scale? Because there's so many little verticals out there, right? You got to have a lot of scale before it really makes a meaningful impact to developers. Things like security, compliance, reliability. There's lots of other challenges too, right? If an app developer sort of goes down, that creates a problem for us, okay. Right? And so there's a big sort of vetting aspect to it.
So final word, Glen, you get the parting shot. So securing cardholder data. So I guess none of this matters if we don't do that. So I'll do the challenges and opportunities in that area.
Thank you. I think the challenges include things like education and driving adoption. If you look at where the biggest issues come for the merchant, it's in cases where we've got things like stored prohibited data on premise or elsewhere. It's in cases where we've got aging systems, either in the hardware or in the software side. So one thing we've got to do is educate further and drive that adoption of our new standards. If you look at something like our secure commerce architecture, it allows us to link a payment terminal to any type of open system in a very secure manner and allow the two to communicate, driving a new experience, but at the same time holding at its core that secure presence. So I think the fact that we can now drive a whole new set of experiences that will have a whole new data set actually gives us another problem to solve, which is we've got to keep those data sets just as secure. Now we're talking about authentication and driving CRM and being integrated into that ecosystem. We're going to have to treat that level of data with the same kind of scrutiny and maniacal focus as we have the secure payment data in the past.
So I think we're just about out of time. Anything we should maybe we'll do one more go round with any parting shots you'd want to leave us with. Why don't we just go down the row, John?
Sure. Yeah. Future point of sale. It's kind of up to everyone in this room, and you know we're happy to work with anyone to help create that future. And I'm really happy that we're all kind of thinking the same way. It's what's going to push the industry forward.
Right. Yeah, Lisa.
Yeah. Welcome to the revolution.
I like it. I like it, Oscar. That's a tough act to follow.
So, I mean, for sure, next generation payment methods will evolve. New technologies are going to emerge, and new payment methods will be created. I think our mission is to be able to provide merchants the ability to accept payments anywhere, in any form, but with one big caveat, and that's we cannot sacrifice security. Mm-hmm. Security has to remain at the forefront of everything.
Right.
I agree. We've got an entire room of people with a role to play here in the future of the point of sale. I think we need to be maniacally focused on the experiences we're providing. We've got an open window now to broaden the point of sale into a far greater scale of experiences. Let's get them right.
Okay, great. John, Lisa, Oscar, Glen, thank you very much.